preparing your technology for travel abroad. Hi everyone, Leo Notenboom here for askleo.com. Yep, I'm finally going to travel again. I'm planning on making an international trip at the end of this month. And I wanted to use that opportunity to review a couple of the preparations that I'm making, especially because in recent years, the landscape has kind of sort of changed in a lot of different ways. Not all of them, but some of them. And also there are a few lessons that I've learned and you can learn from the experiences of others that have come to Ask Leo. So the very first thing, and this is probably going to annoy everybody that pays attention to me over the years, is that I want you to back up. I talk about backing up all the time. There's two different things here, though, about backing up that I want you to pay particular attention to. One is I want you to make sure that your regular backups for whatever technology you have at home are working, that they're working well, and that while you're gone, they will continue to work. I also want you to check those regular backups to make sure that you're keeping the backups long enough. The scenario that I'm concerned about, that I think you should protect yourself from, is the day after you leave, if something happens to your machine. You've got a backup of the day before, but will that backup still be there when you get back? Now, in my case, I'll be gone for about a week, and my backups are being kept for about a month. So no matter what happens while I'm gone or when it happens, if something happens, I will still have the backups I took from before my departure in order to restore my machine. So just make sure that the backups are going to hang around longer than you're going to be away. The other backup I want you to take is of whatever technology you're taking with you. In my case, that'll be my laptop. I want a full image backup of my laptop, ideally the day before or the day of my departure. That way, no matter what happens to the laptop, because of course, things can happen to your stuff while you're traveling, I will still have an image of what was on it the day I left. That can be important and can protect you from data loss and a bunch of other things. So before you even leave, back up. Now, speaking of losing your devices, it happens. In fact, it's surprising how often it apparently happens. The news that I keep running across is how many laptops are left at security. I can't imagine leaving my laptop at security. It's like I'm like paranoid about leaving it behind somewhere. It's that important to me. It's what I do. But apparently it happens. And there, of course, are other ways that your technology can get lost or stolen. So one of the things that I want you to do, I want you to consider, is enabling full disk encryption, like BitLocker, on any laptops and any external hard disks. That way, if somebody steals it, they won't be able to get at the information on the disks. That can be important, that depending on what it is you carry with you, yeah, you might want to make sure that somebody can't get at that. You also want to make sure that you can't just turn on your machine and be logged in. Make sure that Windows requires a password or a PIN before you can log in. That's an important part of protecting your data with BitLocker, but it's also an important part of just keeping all of your other online accounts secure. I know that it's convenient at home not to have to log in, but when you're traveling, that convenience is not worth it. Make sure that a login is required whenever you come back to your machine, be it powering up or coming back from standby. And of course, before you go, ensure that your security software is as up-to-date as possible as well. In Windows, that means running Windows Update a few times so that you make sure you've got the latest Windows Defender, Windows Security, and so forth. Depending on what software you use, you may need to take a few extra steps. That's fine. I want you to do that the day before you leave or the day you do leave, specifically because, depending on where you go, you may have troubles getting more updates. That you may see that as a good thing, depending on your specific examples, but it does mean that there is a possibility that you will not get further updates for your security software. So you at least want to get the most recent before you walk out the door. Hopefully you'll continue to get updates. I'm not saying that you shouldn't get updates while you're traveling. I honestly, truly believe that you should. But I'm saying that depending on where you're going, internet can be flaky, situations can be weird, it's possible that you may not get all the updates that you would otherwise get. So make sure that that's happening. Now, this one, I want to talk about your online accounts. Forget the machines for a moment and just talk about the accounts that you plan to use while you're traveling. Usually those are accounts like your email accounts, your social media accounts, and so forth. For one, I want you to make sure that they've got strong and unique passwords. Don't the usual security litany. I also want to make sure that you have enabled two-factor authentication if at all possible. If someone happens to get your password while you are traveling and you don't have two-factor authentication enabled, they're instantly into your account, right? It's just easy for them to get in. If you've got two-factor enabled, that at least places an additional hurdle in the way of hackers, usually one that hackers won't try to get through unless you're some kind of a high-value target or something that they will just ignore. The problem with two-factor is you have to make sure that your second factor will work when you travel. So when you get to your destination and you try to log into your machine and it requests that second factor, will it work? For example, if your second factor is text messaging, SMS-based, then if you haven't brought your phone on your trip, and or if you don't have a plan, a data plan or a telephone plan that actually allows you to receive text messages wherever it is you may happen to be, you're not going to get that code. You won't be able to log in. Whenever possible, I use Google Authenticator because it is not network-based, it's time-based, and my Google Authenticator works wherever I happen to be, whether or not I've got internet connectivity or not. What is concerning, of course, is that, well, Google Authenticator tends to run on your smartphone. What if you lose your smartphone? One of the things that I also do is use a program called Authy, which is a Google Authenticator compatible tool that allows me to actually have more than one second factor. I will have Authy on my phone, of course, since that's the primary second factor, but I'll also have it running on my laptop or another computer that I have access to, so that even if I lose my phone, I have not lost access to those second factors. I don't necessarily have it running on my laptop itself. I may have it running on a machine here at home that I might access through remote desktop, but the point is that losing your phone, if you're using something like Google Authenticator compatible tools like Authy, doesn't necessarily mean you've lost access to your second factor. There's a flip side to this. And that is that, and I hear from this from all the time, for apparently more often than not from Microsoft email users. So Outlook.com is what we're primarily talking about now. And that is that when you're traveling, you log into your email in the morning at home. And then some hours later, you try to log into your email from a completely different country. Honestly, that is a sign of hacking. That is a sign that, you know, maybe we better check twice. Because what does it look like when a hacker accesses your account? All of a sudden, they're trying to log into your account from a completely different country. Well, now you're trying to do the same thing. What that means is that the service may throw up some additional security verification, usually in the form of a code sent to your text, or a code sent to an alternate email address. If you don't have access to those, or if you haven't even set those up, or if they are not current, you won't get the code and you won't be able to sign in. In my case, what I've done is I have set an alternate email address to a completely different email provider, Proton Mail, as it turns out. I should be able to log in there. That will use a second factor that is time-based. In other words, it'll be on my phone, so I should be able to log in to that service from anywhere. And then, should my Microsoft account require me to jump through an additional hoop to prove that I'm not a hacker in another country, I can just have that send me the code I need to the Proton Mail address and be able to enter it in. The important thing is not necessarily to do it this way, right? Don't necessarily assume you have to use Proton Mail or do this or do that. The important thing is to realize that it's a possibility and make sure that whatever alternate authentication mechanism you happen to have works in the country or in the location that you're going to. As long as you can ensure that, you can be a little bit more confident that you'll be fine when you get to your destination. Now, I've got another way to test that as well. One of the things that I do want you to plan on getting access to is a VPN. We normally think of VPNs as ways to protect yourself from eavesdropping, especially when you're using things like an open Wi-Fi hotspot. The same is true for hotels. Hotels can be just as vulnerable. So protecting yourself using a VPN makes sense when you are traveling, and especially when you're traveling in a foreign country. Don't use a free VPN. Use one that you pay for. Use a reputable one. I happen to use Proton VPN. TunnelBear is another one that I've used in the past. Both of those are fine. Proton VPN happens to work really well for me these days. I've been pretty pleased both with its design, its usability, and its performance when I'm actually using it. There are another reason to use a VPN is that you may need to make it, quote unquote, look like you're at home. For example, in that previous scenario where Microsoft suddenly decides, hey, you're in another country, you need to jump through some additional hoops, you may be able to use a VPN to make it look like you're back at home in your home country. In the case of Proton VPN, you can use their service to make it look like you're in the United States, regardless of where you happen to be. That can help. Doesn't always work, but it can help. So it's another piece of safety net. I mentioned testing that scenario earlier. Grab your VPN before you leave. Make sure you know how to use it. Make sure it's installed and configured properly. Then, if you can, set the VPN to make it look like you're in the country you're about to visit. Now, start trying the various services that you expect to use while you travel. If they continue to work, great. It does two things. One, it lets the service know, like in the case of Microsoft, it would let Microsoft know that, hey, this account that is usually in the United States, sometimes it logs in from another country, this other country, and that's okay. So they may not necessarily see a sudden login from the country you're traveling to as quite as suspicious, and they may not then throw the additional hoops at you. On the other hand, they might. In which case, you can jump through those additional hoops before you leave and hopefully also clear up that scenario. Still be able to respond on the fly in that other country. None of this is guaranteed to eliminate the problem, but it can help reduce the probability that it'll happen. Now, this next one is a little odd, but bear with me. Bring a brick. And by a brick, I don't mean a brick. I mean a power brick. Here's an example of one. This happens to be Elements by Celestron. This is nothing more than a USB battery. So I keep it charged and I can then use it to recharge my phone or whatever other USB device I have while I'm running around, while I'm traveling, while I'm sightseeing or whatever. When we're at home, it's very common for us to be close to our charging ability. So for example, as I sit here at my desk, I could charge my phone if I want to. It's not a big deal. But when you're traveling, it's very common that you're away from your hotel, from your friends, from wherever for longer periods of time. So as a result, battery anxiety towards the end of the day is not that uncommon. Running out of juice with your phone while you're running around is not that uncommon. This saves the day simply because it allows you to charge or top off your phone whenever you feel like it. This particular one has a dual purpose, and it's the reason I have this one. It is also a hand warmer. Now that sounds really silly, but as it turns out, depending on where you're traveling, that can also be a very, very useful thing. But my point here is more about the battery than the hand warmer. Use the battery, take a battery, have it charged when you leave, especially long days of travel. Again, that's another case where this comes in really handy. But make sure you've got one. Keep it charged when you're in your hotel room before you leave. throw it in a pocket when you're out for the day, and then use it if your phone or other device gets too low. Now, one of the things that sometimes is a little controversial is I'm going to suggest you scan your documents and place them in the cloud. Now, at a very basic level, that means things like your airplane ticket, your hotel reservation, your car reservation, if you have one, in my case, some parking reservation. I put those all in Dropbox. I go a little bit further, and I want you to at least consider doing this. I also scan my personal identification. Now, I use Boxcryptor to make sure that it is secure in the cloud. But with Boxcryptor, I can now access those images wherever I happen to be that happens to have internet. The reason I find that so important is not because somebody's necessarily going to accept those as your ID, but rather if you lose your ID, somebody picks your pocket or steals your passport or steals your wallet or whatever, having a photo, a scanned photo of the ID can absolutely make getting its replacement that much easier, especially if you're overseas. So consider that. I'm not going to necessarily say you should do it, but it is something that I'm doing that I feel very secure about doing, and I think will protect me from some possible scenarios that would otherwise be, well, fairly annoying. Finally, this trip, my trip, I'm going to travel light. What that means is that I'm not taking a quote-unquote real camera. I'm going to rely on my phone, there it is, my Pixel, for not just being a phone, not just being email while I'm out and about, but also being my camera. That's one of the things that has really improved over the years are the cameras that are available in your mobile devices. Now, normally, I would actually pack and check a bag and throw a real camera in there because I like using my real camera. I love the results. I have heard some things about the airport that I'm flying through, Amsterdam, that there's a labor shortage, and one of the places where it's really showing up is in luggage handling. I don't want to lose my luggage, so I'm going to travel light and only carry carry-on. That means I actually need to throw out a few things, like the bigger camera, the bigger lenses, the tripod, that kind of stuff. So for this trip, I'm traveling light. I'll be traveling with my Pixel, which will be my camera, could also be my Kindle reader. I may or may not take my iPad because it's a better Kindle than the phone. And of course, I'll be taking a laptop. But from the technology perspective, that's about it. Aside from, you know, the battery that I talked about, the ability to charge whatever I have, it is, you know, whatever I have at my hotel or at my friend's location. But the bottom line is that I'm just not taking a whole lot, because there's a whole lot in what I'm taking. So I hope that was helpful. The most important thing you can do before you travel, be it locally or internationally, is plan ahead and make sure you've got the important things covered. The neat thing, for example, about using my phone, it'll back up the pictures to the cloud automatically whenever I take them. That's going to be important to me. That's what I want to have happen. Think ahead, plan ahead, and to the extent that you can, cover your bases so that you can focus on enjoying your trip rather than trying to recover from some kind of technology-based disaster. Hope that helps. For updates, for comments, for related links and more, visit askleo.com/147914. I'm Leo Notenboom, and this is askleo.com. Thanks for watching.